So I'm going to give you the first talk about when a function is an output predicate. And today's plan, we're going to have four talks. I'm going to give the first one. And Benny sitting there, going to give the second and fourth. So while Yuda was speaking, I thought that probably you can give this day, the talks of this day, 20 years ago, or to say 30 years ago. Not much has changed regarding at least what I'm going to speak today. Maybe some proof been improved, etc., but the basic stuff is the very, very basic stuff in cryptography. And those feasibility results, again, were proven a long time ago. So, I guess also that the evidence varies. There's a very different level. Some people know a lot, and some people, maybe it's the first time for them to meet and encounter this notion. So I'm going to aim for the low level, for those of you that this is the first time hearing about one I found in food order generators, etc. So for the others that are more familiar, I guess, hopefully you have a laptop or something. Let's speak about online material. So first, the online material available is the book by Oleg Goldreich, who wrote the book about foundation photography. There's a link there. It's not the final version of the book, but it's a good enough draft. And also, there are a lot of lecture notes available. This one is by me, which is rather similar at least to the talk that I give. But there's also other good lecture notes available online, so you're very welcome to give them a look. Okay, yeah, just before we begin, so we do assume basic knowledge of probability theory, computational models, etc. Still, if something is unclear, you're very welcome. Actually, we encourage you to ask questions. Maybe this is one of the differences between school and just workshop. That questions are most welcome and very important. Okay, so otherwise it's going to be much shorter than you had planned. And at least me, at least to the next bullet, I sometimes keep some details left as an exercise for you, probably Benny as well. I also sometimes slightly cheat. I don't know about Benny, but this is when I cheat, or somewhat cheat, I want to say when it happens. Also, I think it's true for both of us, slides are slightly different from the version you have in mind, not too different, but, you know, I fix some typos and error, put probably new typos and new errors, but, okay. And again, to emphasize, please, you're very, very welcome to ask questions and to make it more interactive talk and not me speaking and you listening. Okay. So I'm going to speak about what theoretical cryptographers see as the most basic entity in cryptography, which is one-way functions. What are these one-way functions? Those are easy to compute functions, okay, for some range, some domain to some range, which are hard to invert. Let me emphasize that they are easy to compute everywhere. I'm going to put more formally in the next slide, and they are hard to invert on the average. It might be that there are some specific input you can find is pre-range, but the average is going to be hard. Okay? And why should you care about them? Okay, so I told you that it's a very basic tool in cryptography, very basic, the basic primitive in cryptography, but still, it's a good, maybe it's the right point to stop and ask why should we care about one-way functions. So we should care about one-way functions for two reasons. First, they are hidden in almost any cryptographic primitive. Namely, every cryptographic primitive, almost any cryptographic primitive, I'm not going into more details, is essentially contains some form of one-way function. Okay, so understanding one-way function is understanding the minimal assumption for cryptography. Okay, this is the minimal assumption. If one-way function don't exist, most of the cryptography you are interested in does not exist at all. So this is for the lower bound. For the upper bound, it's what the topic of today talk is, that the minimal assumption that one-way function exists suffices for very, very rich to create very, very rich clusters of cryptographic primitives like the one we see today. Okay? This is why you should care about one-way function. So let me give you more formal definition, that I will walk you through the definition. So one-way function is first polynomial type computable function, namely the existing algorithm that runs in polynomial time is the input, and getting an input in the range, output the output of the function. Okay? And such function is one way if for any PPT, for any probabilistic polynomial running time algorithm, the following: the probability this algorithm getting a random output of the function, when I say random output, you mean you take a random input and compute the function of this input. Okay, this is what I say, random output. So a probabilistic time algorithm gets a random output of this function, the probability that it finds a predicate of the function, might be many, might be collision, but find one of them, is negligible. Well, negligible means that it's smaller than inverse polynomial. More formally, for every polynomial P, for large enough n, it holds that the probability this algorithm finds a preimage is smaller than 1 over p of n. Okay? So again, but forget about the very, very formal definition, though we're going to speak about it further in the next slide. No efficient algorithm, this is an efficient function, that no efficient algorithm can infer that more than negligible success probability. Okay? And that's a notational convention. We typically don't give or omit the 1 to the n from the input parameter of the inverter. We need it because otherwise one can cheat, simply think about a function that output a 1 bit. Therefore, an algorithm could not invert it because in the 1 bit input length, it doesn't have the time to output the input. But we typically want to speak about length possessing one function. You can omit it from the input. So once I gave this definition, there are many questions to ask. First, why efficiently computable functions? Maybe it's not that interesting. We can speak about any function is algorithmic. But both for the minimal, for the lower bound, also for the upper bound, we need this property. In particular, if we want to create an efficient cryptographic primitive and want to start from one function, we are better start with the function which we can compute, right? I still say this point because in other fields, in complexity theory, it is of interest to consider non-efficient out-of-invert function, but not in our case. Yes?
You encourage us to ask questions, one sure. Specific question. Can't you swallow the problem you mentioned due to the constants if you have just one bit? And can't you just put...
I guess, but maybe you can out log in it. You cannot. An explanation. But still, we focus on length preserving one function, not going to an issue. Also, second, we say out of the average, right? We said that we require that the function going to be out, not only the extreme case. It's not for every algorithm there's one image that is out inferred, but rather on the average. And again, this is. If you think what you'd like to do with such function, it's like if you think about encryption, it's not enough that you cannot decipher one ciphertext. We want that on the average is out to decipher any X, or any ciphertext. Okay? So it's a necessary requirement when you consider cryptographic primitives to be out of the average. One point that one can argue about is why do we require negligible success probability? It's smaller than 1 over poly, and not exponentially small success probability. And this is a fair question, and one can come with the alternative definition, asking that no algorithm can invert more than 2 to the minus n over 2 success probability. At least in this talk, I focus on negligible success probability because it simplifies the notation, etc. But we can give a very similar talk using different hardness, or what you call epsilon t hardness, to be more specific about the running time of the inversion algorithm and the success probability. Also, I focus on probabilistic polynomial time algorithm. Again, one can consider allow the attacker to have more running time. Yeah, for simplicity, I focus on this case. But important issue is algorithm. Okay, I said it should be an algorithm, Turing machine. And it's fair to ask why algorithm, maybe why not consider circuit, which is a non-uniform algorithm. And I'm going to give the formal definition next slide, but again, it's make our life simpler, this talk. And again, it's all related, this is but asymptotic, not to the one function, it might be that it's very easy to invert on any input of length smaller than 1,000 bits or 1 million bits. Okay, we speak about asymptotic. This is the original definition, there are many motivations for that, but again, almost all the proofs I'm going to give you, the reduction I'm going to give you, can be tailored for a specific n. Okay, so even though everything said is only guaranteed to be for large enough n, when you're going to use one function, or assume something is hard, the reduction is going to be, if this function is hard on this length, then this construction, this primitive, this pseudo-value generator is hard on this length. Okay, again, it's going to make a lot simpler in some sense, complicated in other sense. But it's not going to be a big issue in this talk. Okay, so I'm going to quickly mention that what is very known as the alternative to the definition I gave before, which is non-uniform one function, which is essentially the same, but we allow the inverter to get in advance polynomial size advice per input. Maybe when we try to invert the one function of input of size 500 bits, use one advice, and when you try to invert an input of size 1,000 bits, you use a different advice. Okay, this is a fair definition, it has motivation, probably the speaker of the next day is going to focus on such definitions. But again, for the sake of today, one only we can speak about algorithm, uniform algorithm, at least in my talk, probably also, and you can forget about this definition, only know that it exists.
Yes.
So it implies uniform versions, right? I mean, thank you. I mean, a non-uniform algorithm can ignore this advice and get turned into a uniform algorithm. Okay. And again, we focus on uniform settings for the rest of this my talk and Benny's talk. You can think everything is uniform algorithms. Okay. Final technical detail, it's been very convenient to think about the function length preserving. Though it was not in the initial definition, the function might turn short input to very long input, not too long because it runs polynomial time, but still longer than the input, etc. And the function is length preserving if it doesn't do that. Namely, it turns a 505 input, a size input to 505 output. And what nice is the large of generality, you can assume that any one function, if we have a one function, then this one function is less preserving, you can do it in a more efficient way, in a less efficient way, but it's not that important for today. Okay, so for those of you talk, I want to think that one functions are less preserving, and that's one note, one comment about the talk, you can think about it offline, you simply need to pair the input of the function, and the output, and you get it, and turn any one function into a length preserving one function. And so in the following, when we're saying net f from z1 to the n to z1 to the n with a one function, I mean that it's not defined over one input length, it's defined over all input lengths, and it's length preserving. Okay? Good. So this is what I have to say on one function per se for today. What now I'm going to use is a weaker form for the function. This is typically what we do. We have one creature and then we say, okay, what happens if we change it slightly or make it weaker? Okay. So, what is a weak one-f function? A weak one-f function is almost a one-f function. There's only one difference, is that it is alpha one way. If no probabilistic polytomic algorithm can invert it, will be larger than alpha to the n. So alpha might be fixed, 1/2. No algorithm can invert probability more than 1/2. It might depend on the security parameter. It might be 1 over n, maybe 1 over n cubed, etc. Okay. Again, it's not that no algorithm can invert this creature, but no efficient algorithm can invert it more than some bound. What bound? This bound. Okay. And does sanity check, you know, that a strong or one function, according to this definition, is simply negligible in one way. Okay? No efficient algorithm can invert it more than negligible probability. Okay? So this is what we call weak one function. And, you know, when you come with the weaker definition, the natural question to ask is, can you convert such weak function into a strong function? By the way, do I have a clock somewhere? Was it that? You? I haven't clicked here. Ah, next time. Okay. So that's good. Okay. Such question, or the answer to this question, is called a hard simplification. Namely, you got a weak creature, and you try to turn it into a hard creature. And it's very, very, trying to do that happens in many, many different fields of computer science, in the Eulerian theory, in complexity theory, etc. And maybe this is the most basic question of hard simplification in the field of theoretical cryptography. Okay? So you get a weak one function, and the question is, can you tell it in a strong one? Why is it interesting? It's interesting because, as I said, one function is a minimal assumption. But maybe if you could not convert weak one function into strong one function, so maybe, you know, there's a different creature which is weak one function, but from this creature you cannot build all the wonderful things you can do for one function. So this one, this is why this question is very important, but also, you know, we want to understand one function better in this talk. So this is a good opportunity to understand what are one function, to look again into the definition, and to play with this, you know, what can you do with one function, to reduce one creature to another, etc. So one can think about this as a case study for one function in cryptography, and one can think about it for really an important theoretical question, and both perspectives are true. Okay. So can you convert or amplify a weak one function into a strong one? And before that, let's look at the opposite side. So we want to go from weak to strong, but can you go from strong to weak? Okay, maybe are there weak one functions which are not, or differently, are there weak one functions which are not one function? Maybe everything that is weak is also strong. So it's also to see that it's not the case. Specifically, assuming there exists one function, then there is a weak one function which is not strong one. Okay? Or clearly, you can simply identity function is weak, is zero weak one, is a one weak one function, which is not a strong one. But I want to speak of something more interesting, something function that is slightly hard, but not really one function. So the claim says that, again, if there's a strong one function, there exists one function, but which is not a strong one, and anyone has an ID for the proof. You can decide. No, it's not fair. Okay. So the answer is very simple. Assume that there is one function. Consider the function g that looks at the first bit on the input. If it's 1, it simply compute f of the input and output it. And if it's 0, it simply output 0, or 0 to the n, if you like to make it length preserving, 0 to the n plus 1. So why is it weak? Or at least, why is it not one function? Because you can invert it probably to 1/2, right? Wait till you get a 0. If you get a 0, give me any input that starts with 0 is a legitimate preimage of 0. On the other hand, why is it not totally easy to invert? And the reason is that probability 1/2, you're going to see output of this form. And if you can invert the model in Bleaching probability, you can turn it easily turn into inverting the original function f with model in Bleaching probability. Okay?
The one is a bit confusing. It should be 0. And the second
one, section. Yes. So, it's not confusing, it's a type. So. It was 0, I fix it. But this was not the interesting case. The interesting case is, can you go from weak to strong in one function? And the answer is yes, unless the function has no hardness at all. But if it's slightly hard, maybe it's delta hard one function, and delta is larger, is not noticeable, is larger than one over poly, for some polynomial, and that's the side note. When I say polynomial in this talk, I mean positive polynomial, okay? Without a generality, or even n to the c, if you want to think about it this way. So if there exists 1 minus alpha weak one function, one cannot invert probability. If it was 1, then it's nothing, right? If every function is weak, 1 weak one function, okay? And because the interesting remains that no algorithm can invert probability larger than 1. But if it's slightly smaller than 1, no algorithm can invert it probability better than 1 minus 1 over n to the fifth, say, then there's this one function. Okay? If you start with a very, very weak one function, still you can get a one function. And what is the idea? You do that, so that is the first thing basically that comes to mind, to use parallel repetition or direct product. Namely, you consider the function that, given different inputs, computes f on each of them and outputs the concatenation of the result. Okay? And why this is the most basic approach? Because, you know, if something is hard, we believe that doing it many times is hard, right? If climbing up the stairs is like hard, can't you do it 1,000 times? Okay? So this is a very common belief for humans that if something is hard, doing it many times is harder. And, but is it really so? Okay? I mean, it is true about climbing the stairs, but is it true when you consider weak one function? And let me say that it's not, on a second look, maybe it's not that clear. Because, for instance, think about matrix multiplication. It takes n squared time to multiply n times a matrix with a vector of length n. But to compute, to do it n times, it doesn't take n cube time, but much less than that, right? Somewhat miraculously, you can compute n different products, but not paying the price of doing n times the basic atomic operation. And indeed, at least in cryptography, we have examples where something is hard, and you do it many times. Something is slightly hard, you do it many times, and it remains slightly hard. It doesn't get into how they look primitive. We have such examples, not rising, but still example. But fortunately, for one of functions, for several for few reasons that I'm not going to mention, well, the distinction between these issues, but recently we're going to give the proof, when you do parallel computation of one function, you do get a strong one function. At least if you repeat them enough times. Okay. This the focus of this part of the talk, the second part of the talk, starting in 20 minutes, but the focus of this part of the talk is how do we go from weak quantum function to strong quantum function, and specifically why parallel repetition of weak quantum function is strong quantum function. Okay, so specifically this is the function. Assume that you have f, which is 1 minus delta weak quantum function, as delta happens to be 1 over poly. If delta is not exactly 1 over poly, look at some poly large enough such that 1 over this poly is smaller than delta. And then you repeat, you consider the function that take tn inputs, where t is essentially log square n over delta. Okay? Again, if delta is 1 over n to the fifth, so this is going to be log n square n to the fifth inputs, and output the concatenation. Okay, this function, okay, is much longer input than the original function. So the claim is, if f is a weak one function, 1 minus delta weak one function, then G is strong one function. Okay, it's not like T, because I'm going to mention it again, so T of N. Why?
No, I can't see. Because of the color.
Now what? No,
it's
okay. T of N equal log square N over theta of N. So clearly G is efficient. Why G is efficient? Well, it simply computes, actually, it computes polynomial many times an efficient function f. Okay? So G is efficient. But is it one way? Okay? This is what we need to show. So to show that G is one way function, it's not sufficient that G is efficient, it should be one way. And note that a slight trick here, because G is not defined, the way I put it, for any input length, only for input length which are Tn times n, okay? But this can be solved, again, using padding, etc., turning into G prime, which is defined for every input length. But for the sake of this talk, think about function G, which is not defined for every input length, only for T of n times n. Okay, and now we prove that G is one way. So we do the only thing we can do, namely use a reduction. We assume, towards a contradiction, that G is not a one-way function, and prove that this contradicts the assumption about F being weak one-way. Okay? Specifically, we assume that this is a probabilistic polynomial time algorithm violating the weak one-wayness, the strong one-wayness of G, and show how to create a second PPT, B, violating the weak hardness of F. Okay? And okay, this is what we do, but I want to mention it's not trivial, because an algorithm for violating the hardness of G can do non-negligibly, but still with very low susceptibility, maybe inverted probability 1 over n to the cube. Well, to invert, to break the weak one-wayness of F, you need to invert probability 3/4. So you need to use an algorithm that succeeds to invert G 1 over n to the cube and go all the way up to inverting F with probability 3/4. Okay? So it's not a triviality that you simply take the inverter for A and inverter for G and immediately use it to invert F with more than what you assume. Okay? Because you assume very little about F, only weak one way. One cannot invert probability 1/2. And we try to create a creature which is much harder to invert. No algorithm can invert probably 1 over n to the cube. Okay. So, still we're going to prove that. So thus, let me get more formal. We assume that G is not one way. What does it mean? It means there exists a probabilistic polynomial algorithm A, and a polynomial P, and an infinite set, such that for every n in this infinite set, A inverts G with probability larger than 1 over 20. This is exactly the counterpositive of G being one way. If it was one way, then for every polynomial A, and for every PPT A, for every P in poly, there exists large enough n such that A cannot invert G with probability more than 1 over P. Because we assume that G is not one way, it means that there exist infinitely many n's, and you call it the set I, such that for every input in this, for every input length in this set, A invert G probably larger than one of the P of N. Okay? This is exactly the counterpositive. And we are not really fixing N, we're going to speak about algorithm. But in your mind, if notation is convenient, you can fit the group specific on one specific n in this set. Okay. Again, so this is the starting point. G is not one way. What does it mean? It means that this is an algorithm that inverts with probability 1 over p for infinity. Okay? And now we need to use, we're going to use this algorithm A and to show how to create an algorithm that invert, to break the weak 1 minus of f for every A in this infinity. Okay, so let's start to do it. Let's start with the naive approach. How would you prove such thing? So the naive approach assumes that A is a bit stupid. Why is it stupid? Because when you try to invert F, a G, sorry, it does so, so let me write G as well. It does so by trying to get this input, and he tries to invert this part, then he tries to invert the second part, then he tries to invert the third part, etc., etc. Okay, he tries to do it in the naive way. Okay, he tries to invert f on each of the output of f. Okay, if this the way it works, then it's very easy to show that if it does well, then the original function is not weak one way. Why? Because if A prime, so I said A works by applying some algorithm A prime on each of the input separately, the parts of its input separately. But I claim that A prime invert F with probability larger, or at least 1 minus delta of F. Why is that? Because if it wouldn't, then what would be the success probability of A? It's probability that A prime successfully invert the first part of the input, times probably the A prime successfully invert the second part of the input, etc., etc. If this is smaller than 1 delta of n, you do the calculation and you get that A does not invert G probably larger than negligible, to n to the minus log n. It's a contradiction. So the only thing that you can think of that prevents this contradiction is the assumption, which is A prime does not do well. Okay, so again, if A would work by applying some algorithm A prime to each of the inputs separately, it's almost immediately to claim that if he succeeds, then the original function is not weak one function. But why should A do so? Think about the matrix multiplication. The way to compute many matrix multiplications is not to do them separately, but rather you combine forces that try to do all the tasks together, in a sense. A less naive approach would assume that A acts sequentially. He tried to invert the first input, maybe get some wisdom from that, and then try to invert the second input, etc. And essentially the same proof goes through, but you can assume nothing from that. Okay? Algorithm try to invert G does not need to invert, does not need to care about the structure of G, try to invert each piece of input separately, but rather do more holistic approach. And you cannot apply such simple analysis. So, what do we do? It works like that. So, assume we've been lucky, and the original weak one function, remember, it's a weak one way, slightly hard, but not very hard, is of the following form. It says the hard core, namely, there exists parts of its range which are very hard to invert. Namely, it has a hidden one-way function, a strong one-way function inside. And apart from that, I don't care. It's very easy. More formally, there's this infinitely sequence of sets, Sn, such that the density of S is at least delta of n, namely the probability when you compute F on a random input that it eats this output set is at least delta of n. And no efficient algorithm can invert F on this set the more the negligible probability. This is what he said, okay? We seem to be very lucky, and this was the structure of it. Basically, it means that the weak one function is as an hidden strong one function inside it, okay? I claim that if this was the case, life seemed to be not too deep, rather good, right? Because what is the intuition? The intuition that if you compute F on many different inputs, and this is exactly what G does, essentially, you're going to eat this output set. And once you eat out this output set, no algorithm can invert it. And know that algorithm to invert G need to invert G on each of its outputs. And he cannot do that because after many times, one of his output is this output tree. Okay? So this looks very promising. But the problem is that you cannot prove that. Okay? Actually, you can, in some sense, you can prove that a one-off function does not have such output, a weak one-off function does not have such output. Okay? So too bad. Okay? No, you cannot prove that such any one weak one-off function is built from some strong one-off function hidden inside. But luckily, you have an equivalent form, a weaker form of output set, which suffices to the proof, which is what we call failing set. A failing set essentially means that it might be that there's no output set for the function, but any algorithm has a failing set of its own. Okay? Maybe one algorithm finds its output invert S from this part, and the second algorithm finds its output invert S from this part, but we don't care. For the proof, it suffices. So this is formally what it means. So a function F is a delta failing set, and this failing set is defined per algorithm and polynomial Q. If for this algorithm, this set is a failing set. Okay? For every set, there exists a set. Okay? For every algorithm and polynomial, there is probably different, possibly different, infinity sequence of set. But still, with respect to this infinity sequence of set, this is the output set for the specific algorithm A and polynomial Q. Namely, this set is large. Okay? It's happening in probability this delta. And A cannot invert output or element in this set with probability greater than one of the key. I basically switch the order of quantifier. Rather than asking that there exists output set for all algorithms, I said no, but for all every algorithm there exists output set. And it turns out it suffices because we don't need this strong requirement we cannot prove. It suffices to have this weaker requirement that you can prove. And you know, there is some boundary to do with you. Is it possible to push this talk like 15 minutes? More, because the second talk I want to put probably a minute less. But with the slides and the coffee, with the breaks and the coffee, everything. Okay. Good. Okay, so this is a failing set. The claim is that if F is 1 minus delta 1, then it has a failing set. Specifically, it has a delta over 2 failing set for any pair of PPTA and Q in one. And actually, the proof is rather simple. How do you prove that? Assume that it doesn't happen. Namely, assume that this for PPTA and Q in such that for every infinite sequence of set, which is large, namely, for any infinite sequence set, either this set is not large, namely, for infinitely many n's, the density of this set is smaller than delta over 2, or for infinitely many n, A can invert some y in this set, we put it in 1 over 2. Again, this is again the counterpositive. What does it mean that A and Q do not have a failing set? It means that any infinite sequence set either is too small or A does too well in set. Maybe not always, but for infinitely many n's. Okay? So this is a assumption. If this is not all, so again, either A and Q have a failing set and then we are good, or this falls for this specific A. And kind of this, if this happens, if there exists A and Q that do not have a failing set, then we can invert F with probability which is larger than the assumed numbers. Anyone sees why? Yeah, we pin down this A and Q, okay? And this A and Q do not have a failing set. So let's give a good candidate for being failing set. The best candidate is simply this element which A does better than, right? Specifically, for every n, let Sn be the set on which all these elements, which probability n is that, is smaller than 1 over 2. Okay? You can define it, right? It's a formal definition, it's a valid formal definition. And I claim that this set must be small, at least for incrementally n. Why is that? Because if the density of this set is large for every n, then this is a failing set. By definition, A does not do well with this set. But we assume that A and Q do not have a failing set. Therefore, by definition, from P to many n, this set is small. But what does it mean that this set is small? That for everywhere outside this set, A does well. This is definition, right? So if A does well everywhere outside this set, and this set is small, it's very easy to amplify this A to break the weak 1 minus of F. Specifically, you do the following. You get the input, consider this polynomial algorithm B, you get the input, you try to invert, choose A to invert it many times, and if you're lucky, you did it once, you're happy. Okay? And the claim this algorithm does very well in inverting F. Why? First, it's running polynomial time. It's by definition, by the parameters, you Q is polynomial as well. And second, what is the probability? I claim that B invert F is very high probability. And why is that? With very good probability, for every n in this infinite set, where S of n is small, either this might be that the F of X might be outside, it's not so inside this this failing set S of n, but this happens with very small probability, okay, with delta n over 2. But if it is not inside this weak set, what happens? It means that A inverting probability increases at least 1 over 2 of n. So if you repeat it many times, what probability do you fail in each of them? 2 to the minus n. So every time you are outside this S of n, B does very well, and to answer the contradiction, you assume that this set is very small. So the probability that it fails in this failing set is only delta of n over 2. And if you combine them together, this breaks the basically, B inverts F on infinitely many n, probability is larger than 1 minus delta of n, which is a contradiction. Okay? So, if anyone lost me, what to prove till now, that it's not that any weak one function has a Hartree set, but every weak one function has a delta over 2 a failing set. Namely, for every algorithm and polynomial, there exist infinite sets which are large, and still A cannot invert F on the probability more than 1 over this polynomial. Okay. Good. Okay, this is the formula. Okay. Again, this is a contradiction to F being more weak one function. Okay, so now we want to prove, to use this understanding, to prove that that G is one way. How are we going to do that? We show that if G is not one way, then F has no delta or two failing set for some PPTB and some polynomial Q. But since F is weak one way, it should have a failing set for every algorithm a B and the polynomial Q. And it's going to be the contradiction. Okay? So, specifically, we're going to show that if G is not one way, that is infinitely set of indices, etc., etc., such that A where G is probably larger than 1 over P, is again the counter positive for being one way. Then, there exists a PPTB such that for every n in this index set, for every for every set which is large enough, Okay? Algorithm B invert a random element in this set with probability larger than this value, which is essentially the success probability over the algorithm breaking test over the number of iterations. Again, if G is not one way, if G is not one way, then there exists an algorithm B that has no failing set, but we said we need only polynomial. This is going to be the polynomial, one of the two Tn Q. Okay, this is what I'm going to show. And it's going to be contradiction. I'm going to prove it next slide, but this is slightly different from not having a failing set. Let me say what I mean. Why it follows that A, that it means that F does not have a failing set. So fix some infinite set S. Okay? So by the above claim, either either this set is small, okay, or B does well with that. But this is for every infinite set. So namely, this set cannot be failing set for algorithm B and this polynomial. But this is polynomial, one of the two Tn Q of n. Okay? Again, this claim immediately follows from this claim that if G is not one way, that this specific algorithm, this very specific algorithm we're going to define next time, and this specific polynomial, this polynomial, which I'm going to define now, okay, for which there exists no failing set. For every set, either it's small or B does well. How well? Better than one of the two for letting this be. Okay? So now, before moving to the next part, I'm going to define, to prove, I'm going to slightly to do it because I'm running out of time. Why does it work? Why, if G is not one way, there is an algorithm that inverts that has no failing set? Namely, for every large enough set, it can invert F of it to large success probability. So is the algorithm? The algorithm gets one input, which is the output of F. You want to invert F, right? But he has access to an algorithm that inverts G. So need to generate in output of G, right? How does it generate output of G? It generates a random output of G. And remember that output of G is combined with many different applications of F. And it takes the Y, the input you want to invert, and put it inside, right? It erases what it chooses uniform at random index and erases what was written there and writes Y instead. Okay? So this formally, syntactically, it looks well, okay? Okay, it looks like output of G. Maybe not a random output of G, but it's an output of G. Right? And now it applies the algorithm, the assume algorithm that inverts G, and retains the relevant invert, the relevant inverse. Right? Again, he has the input of F. He computes a random output of G, put the element you want to invert with F in a random location, apply the assume algorithm for inverting G, and you know, look at the I output of A and return. Oh, so clearly, this is efficient algorithm. Okay? And now, I'm going to show that this algorithm contradicts F being one way, weak one way. And why is that? Think set S. Okay? I want to claim that probability, what we said it suffices, I prove that probability that B in vector Y, when Y is a random out of F condition that is inside this set S, is too good. And why is that? A simple simplicity that A is deterministic. So what A, what B does? By choose a random output of G. Right? This is the bottom line of the proof, so bear with me for 1 minute and we'll be to the next topic, which is hopefully easier. Assume that A is deterministic, okay? And assume, what, how does Z look like? You know, you compute S many times, a different output. Some of them are going to be inside this set S, which is the green part, and some not. I claim that many of them, and then what it does, one second, what it does, it picks a uniform output, some index, and plug is Y, the element it's trying to invert. The element it's trying to invert, if it was inside S, then it's a green one. Right? Okay? Because we only care about what Y B does when we get a random output of F inside S. Okay? And now we apply A, not original output to a random output of G, which we know A does well, but rather to this creature. The creature when you turn one output from blue to green, from maybe it was green before. But anyhow, he writes the green element with his right hand, the element inside this S. And let typical be the set of outputs of G, which has some green part. I claim, because S is not too small, with very high probability, a random output of G is inside this typical, right? Because this is where you set the parameter. So probability that we that when B through the random output of G, that one of this, some of this element is green, is almost 1 minus digit, is 1 minus digit. Good. But now I claim we're good. Why we're good? Because what happened? You choose a random one of G. Some of them are green, right? Unless it's more probability. And what B does, it takes a different green one and put it in another location. With some probability, at least 1 over T, what is it going to be in this random location? A green one. So 1 over T probability, it does nothing. It took it like the joke about some guy taking the tone out of his shoe and then put a new one, you know? It took the green one, it took one, with probability 1 over T, it took one green and put a different green. So now the probability of Z and Z prime are not very different, okay? If something happened with high probability with respect to Z, like what? What happened with not with large probability with respect to Z? Inverting happened with large probability with respect to Z. That's what we assume. It also happened with large probability with respect to Z prime. Right? Well, that doesn't mean it happened with high probability with respect to Z prime. It means that B, with probability, with high probability, when you make this call, A succeeds. A returns invert G. But if it or specifically inverts Z prime, but if it inverts Z prime, what it also inverts? This one. Right? So again, just summing up, was slightly more complicated than I thought. Sorry for that. What, again, why this F does not a failing set if G is not one way? Because for every large set, a random out of G has many elements of this set. And then B, by taking this element of this set and plugging it into a random location, basically it started with Z, with the random element of G. We create almost a random element of G, and therefore A does well on that, and specifically Z. Okay. Let me summarize, and then we move to the next topic, which is shorter, I promise, or simpler. So one function are hidden in almost any cryptographic primitive. Okay? We can amplify weak one-way function into strong one. Okay? Let's start from weak one-way function. The construction is very simple. The proof, as you see, is more complicated than one might think, but still it goes through. And the main question, this is a very, very basic question. We know to solve it more than 30 years, right, since 82. And still, there was no improvement since then. Namely, if you have a weak one-way function, the only thing you need to do is to compute it many, many times to get a strong one-way function. And this is very undesired, it has very undesired effect of blowing up the input length, right? You get a weak one-way function on 100 bit input, and you might get one-way function on 1 million bit input, which is of no use, okay? So there's, even this very, very, maybe first question we need to use in this field, there's open question, can you do better? Can you start with one weak one-way function and create a strong one function without this undesired blow-up in the universe? Okay. So we move to the next topic. Okay. Which, again, for those of you who lost me, hopefully not all of you, but for those of you who lost me in the previous book, you can start again, okay? Take a sip of water, and it's this topic is related, but the proof is unrelated to the previous topic. Okay. So the second topic of this talk is what called how to predicate. And let's start with informal discussion. So if f is one way, again, remember, it means given f of x, it is hard to find x. But it does not say that it's hard to find all of x. Actually, part of x might be very easy to find. For instance, assume that you have one function f. Consider the function g that takes two inputs. So the first part is compute f of x, and the second part is simply output it. It is very easy to see, again, easy exercise, to show that if f is one way, g is also one way. But definitely, now x is x and y, and w, sorry. Clearly, the output of g does not hide all of its input. You see half of its input. This is w. It's simply written in the clear. So this means that one cannot hope that when you get one function, it's hide all its input. So, what can you do? It turns out it has many, many applications if you can have something which is hidden about the input. Specifically, can you find some function of f, hopefully efficiently computable, that given f of x, it's out to compute this function? Okay? Again, given f of x, it might be very easy to compute part of x. Not all of x, because then it means that you invert one function, but part of x. But maybe there's a bit of x is without. Maybe a few bits of x are still out. Or if you are lucky, if you are less lucky, maybe there's some function of x which is out. Okay? And as we see next talk, but many, if we have such hardcore predicate, it has many, many applications. Not only for what many talk, but also apart from that. What call if a function has some this hardcore predicate, what we call a function of x. That given f of x is out-compute, it is very, very useful primitive. So let me be more formal. A polynomial computable predicate p is the out-compute predicate of function f. If no efficient algorithm, given the output of f, can compute this g of x. Again, this is the game. The algorithm is getting output of f. His goal in life is not to compute x, but only compute one bit. Which bit? B of x. You can think about B of x, maybe to be the first bit of x, maybe the sum of all the bits of x. Okay? But if a function has such predicate, then you say that this function is a hard code predicate. Okay? Why hard code? Because again, not all x is R given f of x, but some function of x is R given f of x. The question to ask is, does any one function is hard code predicate? Maybe every function is a hard code predicate. Okay? It's not going to be the case, but to be more specific, doesn't one of any one function is hard code predicate? Maybe there's a generic hard code predicate. Maybe the first bit of every one function is hard code predicate. One cannot predict the first bit of any one function, the input of any one function. Maybe the second bit, maybe the XOR of all these bits. Okay? Again, our goal in this part is you're given present a one function, you know nothing about it, but it's the one function. Can you find some function of its input, efficiently computable, a predicate, namely its output only one bit, which is how to compute given the output of the function. Okay, so let me picture it.
You just proved that you can't do it deterministically.
Right. 1 second. So this is f, f of x, and this is one bit, go to b of x. Both of them are computable. Okay? We know that it is how to go this way. Why is it how to go this way? Because f is, but is it how to go this way? We need to prove that it's how to go this way. Okay? Okay? Again, this is what we assume, that f is one way, it's how to go from f of x to x. But as we see, maybe it's easy to compute some part of x. And we need to show that there exists some b, efficiently computed b, such that it's how to go from f of x to b of x. So first I want to claim that not every, there's no generic output predicate. There's no one function predicate which is output predicate for any one function. Why is that? I give you one function, consider the function f of x, b of x. This is still efficient function, because b is efficiently computable. It's very easy to show that it's one way. You're getting an advice, but it's one bit advice, not going to help you. But clearly, b of x is not output predicate of g. Why is it not output predicate of g? Because it's written in the output. No, it's not that hard to copy, doesn't copy and paste from the output and say, here is b of x. So this proves that there's no generic output predicate. There's no one function. The XOR of the bit is not output predicate of any one function. The fifth bit is also not output predicate of any one function, etc. But still, maybe every one function is output predicate of its own. Right? We don't need it. So the best thing would be to find a generic output predicate. But this cannot be done, so maybe every one function is output predicate of its own. A second question to ask is, does the existence of output predicate imply that f is a one function? Maybe every function is the output predicate. And the answer is, this is not the case. Namely, some functions, which are clearly not one way, is output predicate. For instance, think about this function. You simply output the first bit of it, the first part of it. It's not one way, but given x, simply guess y, and x and y are going to be a preimage of f. But still, if y is one bit, then you cannot compute it information theoretically, or probability better than 1/2. You cannot compute y from x, because it's not written there. Right? So information theoretically, this function f, which is not one way, is an output predicate. But the interesting case is the case if f is one way. And if f is one way, this does not happen, because if it's one way, then you can, if f is one-to-one, sorry, injective, then it's easy to show that if it's not one way, it's easy to go from here to here, then it does not have output predicate. Why? Because here's the output predicate. You go, you get f of x, you compute x, and then you can easily compute b. Right? So if f is one-to-one, having output predicate, it means that it's also one way. Okay? What went wrong here in this example is because when you went from here to here, if f is not one way, you are not getting x, you get something which might be different than x. Okay. Let me skip this slide. And I'm going to define a function, efficient compute function, which is for every function that says we're going to see next, I'm going to prove that it exists the output predicate. Okay? It's what's called the Golder-Kalevin output predicate. So that's one notation. Given two n-bit strings, the inner product mod 2 is the following equation. You take n-bit string, you multiply each of the bits, and sum it up, mod 2. Or differently, you XOR all of them. Okay, again, you get x and n out, so you get x1 till xn, r1 till rn. You multiply each of the bits and XOR them, or differently, sum them up and do mod 2. Okay, this is the inner product mod 2. So the Golder-Kalevin says the following. Let f be one function. Consider a different function, g, which is very similar to f. It has two n-bit input. For the first part of input, simply compute f. And the second part, it outputs it in the, as it is. Let me x go to f of x, and r goes to r. Okay? Then b, which is in the inner product mode 2 of the two parts, the two input part of g, is output predicate of g. Again, if f is one way, you can define g, which is easy to show that it's also one way, by the way. And then, this g is an output predicate. Which output predicate? It is the inner product of the two parts, mod. Note that if f is one way, as we said before, it is to show that also g is one way. More importantly, if f is one to one, what about g? It's one to one, right? So if there's no cheating, g, if f is one to one, g might be one to one. So it's not that it's an output predicate because of cheating. If it's a real output predicate. You cannot achieve such output predicate for one to one, not one way function. This is not cheap doing, right? I promise you they're going to define for every one function this output predicate, but rather, I started from one function f, I created a different output function, one function g, and then I say this g is output predicate. And we don't know, maybe every one function has an output predicate, we don't know if it's true or not, probably it's not. But, maybe different one, but we don't know it, but rather, we start from f, slightly change it, but not in too drastic way. The input length is not so different. We only double the input length. If it was 1 to 1, it remained 1 to 1, etc. So it's almost as good as the original f. And now, for this function, we have output predicate. Which output predicate? This output predicate. And we're going to prove it for some less detail than the previous proof. Don't worry. And we prove it by deduction. What does it mean by deduction? This is the only thing basically we can do. We assume that this function, this predicate, is not the output predicate of g, and contradict the one-wayness of f. Okay? We assume that this algorithm that predicts b of x from the output of g too well, and we use it to invert f. Okay? Any question about the definition of this output predicate? Okay? Very simple operation of the input. Okay? Not as simple as output one bit, but still very, very, very efficient operation of the input. And we claim, we're going to prove that the output predicate of G, assuming G is one. Okay. Others want to prove it that bit more specific, assume that again this B is not the output predicate of G. Namely, there exists an efficient or probabilistic polynomial term A and a polynomial P such that to infinity many n